Good morning, children. So now today's class will begin the next chapter, that is magnetism and matter. See, in the previous chapter of magnetic effects of electric current or moving charges of magnetism and magnetism, okay, we have studied how is magnetic field produced by a current carrying circular coil, then various shapes of conductors. Okay, there we have defined that a rectangular loop or a circular loop of coil carrying current behaves as a magnetic dipole. So everything about how a current carrying conductor can produce a magnetic field, okay, we have studied by using Biot-Savart's law and Ampere's law. Okay, whereas coming to this particular chapter, okay, here we'll be going to study about classical magnetism. Okay, that is the magnetic field produced by magnetic substances, okay, such as bar magnets, and then how to classify the substances based on their magnetic properties into ferro, para and diamagnetic materials. You'll also study about Earth's magnetic field. Okay, so to begin with, today we will just start with some basic properties of a bar magnet. Okay, all of you are familiar with a bar magnet. Okay, what are the basic properties of a bar magnet? Okay, we know bar magnet has attractive properties. Okay, two major properties that you can study is it has attractive property. Okay, we know magnets have ability to attract ferromagnetic materials like such as iron. Okay, then second property is light poles always repel and unlight poles attract. Okay, third is directional property. A freely suspended bar magnet always aligns, pointing out the geographic north and south. It is actually magnetic north and south, which is close to geographic north and south. So there are three major properties that you have studied. One more you can write is monopoles do not exist. See, when you cut a magnet, again you get a north and south pole. Individual north pole and individual south pole will never exist. So actually the word magnet is derived from a Greek island, the name of a Greek island, that is Magnesia. Okay, where we find abundant source of magnetic ores. Okay, since the ore was discovered in this region, it was named as a magnet. Okay, long back, maybe about 600 BC, the magnets were being discovered. And it is observed that even Chinese started using the magnets far before that. In 200 BC, they used magnets as magnetic compass needles while sailing in the ship. For a bar magnet, let us see how are the magnetic field lines distributed. Okay, so hope you remember how are magnetic field lines for a bar magnet. Okay, just like we have drawn for electric dipole. If this is the north and south pole, the field lines of a bar magnet are directed away from north pole towards a south pole. Okay, outside the magnet, the field lines are directed away from north and towards south. Actually, the magnetic field lines always form closed loops. This is how the field lines are present. If I draw more number of field lines, look at the field lines of a bar magnet. This is the north pole and this is your south pole. They are directed away from north outside the magnet towards south. But look inside the magnet, how are the field lines? They are moving from south pole to north pole. Okay, the properties of magnetic field lines. How are the field lines directed? Away from north, towards south outside the magnet. And inside the magnet, they move from south pole to north pole. Okay, this is how the magnetic field lines are distributed. And because the magnetic field lines always form a closed loop, if you observe the properties of magnetic field lines, okay, just like we have studied the properties of electric field lines, I'll put the values together. See, the first point says that they are directed from north to south outside, south to north inside. Second point, they always form closed loops. Okay, this is one point which differentiates electrostatic field lines with magnetic field lines. We know electrostatic field lines will never form a closed loop, electrostatic field lines, whereas magnetic field lines always form a closed loop. Then third property is the tangent drawn to the field line will indicate the direction of magnetic field. Okay, the tangent gives you the direction of magnetic field. Since tangent gives the direction, no two field lines intersect each other. Okay, this is similar to that of electric field lines, because if they intersect, electric field will have two, magnetic field will have two directions. Is it practically possible? No. So no two field lines will intersect. The number of field lines through a given surface, through a given area, will indicate the strength of magnetic field. Okay, whether the field is stronger or weaker can be identified by considering the number of field lines. More field lines through a given area, field is very strong. Less field lines through a given area, we say the field is weaker. So these are the five properties that you can remember regarding the magnetic field lines. Again, I'm repeating, they always form a closed loop directed from north to south outside, south to north inside. Direction of magnetic field is given by the tangent. Then no two field lines intersect each other. The number of field lines through a given area is a measure of the strength of magnetic field. So what is the difference between electric field lines and magnetic field lines? Electric field lines will never form, electrostatic field lines will never form closed loop. What is the similar points? The remaining points are similar. So this is all about the properties of magnetic field lines. Now let us compare and prove that a solenoid, okay, we have studied solenoids in the previous chapter, can behave as a bar magnet. Okay, now we are going to study one small derivation, okay, which is going to prove that a bar magnet has an equivalent solenoid. Okay, we know if you consider a solenoid, okay, we know how do we define a solenoid? A wire which is winded in the form of a helix into n number of turns like this. Okay, consider one solenoid carrying the current I. Okay, let its radius be taken as A. Okay, this is the center of the solenoid. I'll consider this as my x-axis and y-axis. Length of the solenoid is 2L, from minus L to plus L. So for this solenoid, okay, which is carrying the current I. Okay, assume that current in the solenoid is taken as I. What is the radius I'm considering it as? Small a. So now for a point P which is at a long distance or at a distance small r from the center, we are interested in finding out the magnetic field. Okay, now by finding the magnetic field on its axial line, we are trying to prove that the field is similar to that of an electric dipole. Okay, let us start with taking a small part of the solenoid. Okay, I'll consider only a portion of it whose thickness is dx. I'm not taking the whole solenoid, only a circular loop of thickness dx, which is at a distance x. Okay, from the axis to the center, I'm taking the distance as x. And from here to here, the distance is r. So since it is a circular loop of coil, the number of turns in this thickness, okay, if small n represents number of turns per unit length, what will be the number of turns in thickness dx? Can I write it as n into dx? Small n is number of turns per unit length. Length I have taken as dx. The product will give you the number of turns in this shaded region. So what is the magnetic field dB along axial line of a circular loop of wire? We know the formula. It's mu naught ni a square by 2 into x square plus, okay, r square, because I took the distance as what is the distance from center to this point? This is r and this is x. So from center till here, the distance becomes r minus x. R minus x whole square plus a square whole to the power 3 by 2. Again, I'm repeating, from center of the shaded portion till the point P. Distance is r minus x. Generally we write it as x square plus r square whole power 3 by 2. Here radius is taken as a and distance is r minus x whole to the power 3 by 2. Now replace this capital N as n into dx. What is dB equal to? Mu naught n into dx I into a square divided by 2 into r minus x whole square plus a square whole to the power 3 by 2. Now I need the total magnetic field at this point. Then should I integrate the relation? What are the limits of my integration? I have to move from this point till plus L to minus L. Okay, one limit is minus L, another limit is plus L. So the total magnetic field is integral of minus L to plus L mu naught n into dx I into a square by 2 into r square r minus x whole square plus a square whole to the power 3 by 2. Okay, now I am going to make use of one approximation. Okay, the approximation is, if this r is much greater than x, okay, I am taking this distance very large when compared to length of the solenoid also, and it is already larger when compared to this distance x. If r becomes much greater than L and r is much greater than a, compared to the radius also the distance is very large, compared to size of the solenoid also we have taken a very large distance. Since r is much greater than L and r is much greater than a, if you come back to this relation, if L becomes very small, x also becomes extremely small. So if x is much smaller when compared to r, a is anywhere a smaller value, what change will occur in this relation? Integral minus L to L, mu naught is constant, n is the number of turns per unit length, dx I into a square divided by 2 into, you can neglect x and a in comparison with r, r square to the power 3 by 2 will become r cube. Remove the constants. What is b equal to? Mu naught n, I will keep inside, sorry, n I a square by 2 r cube, integral of dx from minus L to plus L. What is integral of dx equal to? X. Limits are from minus L to plus L. Okay, if you put the limits, it will become 2L. So what should be the magnetic field? Mu naught n I a square into 2L by 2R cube. 2 will anyway get cancelled. So I will multiply with 4 pi and divide with 4 pi. Okay, so that we can write it in terms of mu naught by 4 pi. So what is B equal to? Mu naught by 4 pi, I am writing it separately. Look at this term, n I a square into pi, pi a square, is it nothing? Okay, n into small n into 2L into I into a square into pi. All this I am writing in one bracket because n pi a square is area, length of the solenoid is 2L. So total length of solenoid into small n will give you capital N. Pi a square gives you area into I gives you current. Are we left with one more 2 in the numerator? Divided by R cube. So if I replace this as capital N, okay, what is magnetic field coming out to be? Okay, I'll write the equation here. What is your magnetic field? Mu naught by 4 pi into capital N I, pi a square, I'm writing it as area, all this is one term, by r cube into 2. So what is the product of n into I into a called as? Magnetic dipole moment. So if I replace this as mu naught by 4 pi 2 into capital M by r cube. So observe this relation, mu naught by 4 pi 2m by r cube. Is it similar to the magnetic field along axial line of an electric dipole? But instead of mu naught by 4 pi, you get 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught. 2p by r cube is 2m by r cube. So this proves that the magnetic field along axial line of a bar magnet and magnetic field along the axial line of a solenoid, both are similar. So a solenoid is equivalent to a bar magnet, or a bar magnet is equivalent to that of a solenoid. So this is a magnetic field for axial line. Similarly, if you write for a bar magnet, what will be the magnetic field along equatorial line? If this is a short bar magnet and magnetic field along axial line, for equatorial line, you can write it as mu naught by 4 pi into m divided by r cube. Of course, direction will be opposite. Direction of the magnetic moment and magnetic field will be opposite in case of equatorial line. Same in case of axial line. So remember this derivation, where we are proving that bar magnet as an equivalent solenoid. Okay, so therefore, for a bar magnet, tell me, how can we write the magnetic field along axial and equatorial line? If this is the south pole and north pole, remember magnetic moment is directed from south to north, like it is from negative to positive charge in electric dipole. For magnetic dipole, direction of dipole moment is from south to north. So what is the field along axial line? From center, the distance is r. Field along axial line, it's given by the relation mu naught by 4 pi 2 into m divided by r cube for a short bar magnet. If your point is on equatorial line, see, I'm giving the arrow opposite. Dipole moment is this side. Magnetic field will act opposite at a distance small r. Okay, B equatorial is equal to mu naught by 4 pi m divided by r cube. But if your point is neither on axial nor on equatorial line, south and north, so at some point P, which is at a distance r, making an angle theta with the dipole moment. Now we can resolve this dipole into two components. Okay, this is your actual dipole moment m. If I split them into two components, this will be m cos theta towards theta, and this side you have m sin theta. So your point is here. Is m cos theta along the axis? The point P is along the axis of m cos theta. So due to m cos theta, we get the magnetic field as b theta. Okay, not b theta, we call it as br, along the radius vector. So what is the magnitude of br along axial line for m cos theta magnet? That is, for a magnet whose dipole moment is m cos theta, this point is along axial line. So I am writing the radial component as mu naught by 4 pi 2 m cos theta divided by r cube, 2p by r cube or 2m by r cube. Instead of m, I have to use m cos theta. Now, because of this magnet, okay, because of this component, m sin theta is the magnetic moment of this dipole. This is your point. Is this the equatorial line? For equatorial line, magnetic field is opposite to dipole moment. See, if dipole moment is this side, magnetic field will be opposite. We call this as angular component b theta. So how to write the value of b theta for equatorial line? Mu naught by 4 pi m sin theta divided by r cube, just like we have written for an electric dipole. Now the resultant of these two will give you the net magnetic field, which is making an alpha with br. So if you know b theta and br, they are perpendicular to each other. So what is the resultant magnetic field? It is under root br square, radial component, plus angular component. When you simplify this, we get the magnetic field as mu naught by 4 pi m into under root 3 cos square theta plus 1 divided by r cube. So you know the value of dr and da theta. Substitute and simplify, you will get this answer. And what about this tan alpha? What will tan alpha be equal to? Opposite by adjacent. This is b theta by dr. B theta by dr. This term divided by this. M sin theta by m 2m cos theta. Okay, so when I divide these two values, what will you get this answer as? Sin by cos is tan theta divided by 2. So this will give you the direction and this will give you the magnitude. If you have to find the magnetic field of a bar magnet which is neither on axial nor on equatorial line. So hope you know, remember all these formulas we have done even for an electric dipole. So just modify 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught to mu naught by 4 pi and P is replaced with capital M. Okay, now coming to magnetic flux and Gauss law in magnetism. Okay, so we define magnetic flux as the number of field lines, magnetic field lines passing through a given surface. Okay, it's written as integral of B dot ds, or you can also write it as B dot A. Okay, B is the magnetic field and A is the area vector. What is the direction of the area vector? Always perpendicular to the surface. Okay, say there are magnetic field lines along this region. If you keep your surface perpendicular to this, passing through the surface, the number of field lines passing through a given area is indicated by a scalar quantity which is called as magnetic flux. We write it as integral B dot ds, just like electric flux, or B dot A. What will be the SI unit for it? SI unit, magnetic field is Tesla into meter square. Field is measured in Tesla and area is measured in meter square. It is a scalar quantity. So coming to Gauss law in magnetism, just now I told you that magnetic field lines always form a closed loop. Whatever field lines enter from the first surface will leave from the other. Okay, so because they are forming a closed loop, if I take this as a surface, field lines are entering and leaving. So anywhere you consider, the number of field lines have to enter from one side and leave from another. Since the total number of flux passing through a given surface is always zero, what will be your Gauss law in magnetism? Gauss law in magnetism states that the net electric magnetic flux, integral of B dot ds, must be equal to zero. Since magnetic field lines are always closed loops, the net flux through a Gaussian surface will always be zero. What is the significance of this relation? First point is, field lines are always forming closed loops. Second point you can understand is, monopoles do not exist. Unit north pole or only south pole will never exist. Since south pole and north pole alone cannot exist, okay, if I take this as a magnet, it has a north pole and a south pole. So field lines will emerge from north and south, and again inside they will move from south to north. So what is the net flux or the net polarity of this? Always equal to zero. For every positive charge there is a negative charge, for every north pole there is a south pole, like a dipole. What is the number of net flux through a dipole? It will always be zero. Since magnet is a dipole, the net flux will always be zero. It is not Q by epsilon naught like in case of electric dipole. So here we always write it as zero. What is the significance? It proves that monopoles do not exist, or it states that monopoles do not exist. Second, field lines always form closed loops.